Good morning, everyone. I'm the first speaker in the gallery here. My name is Marco Striegel. I'm a build service engineer for the build service. And I'm giving a short lightning talk about the development status and what we are going to do with the new OSC, the OSC 2. Does anyone of you know what the OSC is? Not the OpenSUSE conference, but the command line client. Yeah? Okay, cool. So I don't have to tell you what the OSC is, but I have a short overview just in case anyone does not know it. It's the command line interface for the Open Build Service instance. It's basically the API wrapper, which fires API calls against the Open Build Service. And it's actively developed and it's maintained. So it's a good thing, I think. And it's written in Python. Then I have some numbers. We have, at all, we have 89 commands which can be issued with the OSC. And to these commands, we have already 50 aliases which can be fired to alias a command. So it's very big and very very lot of commands you can do with this OSC. There are 36,000 lines of code, and it's very big. It's, we say, historically grown. So that leads to the question, why we need a rewrite of the OSC? Markus Hüwe, I think most of you know Markus Hüwe, started the rewrite of the OSC. I think it was in 2004, I can't remember anymore, but I think 2004 must be right. And he said that one big problem of the OSC is that, yeah, you have a very inconsistent UI. So we have, you can, for example, if you have the arguments for repository and architecture, you can give them with minus repo or minus arg. You can use the syntax like project package repo arg. Then you can even use minus r and minus a as a as the short forms. Yeah, so it's very inconsistent. You can do, you can give the same argument in very different ways, and that is experience a user as a user I don't want to have. I want to use I want to have the same syntax with every command. The other flaw of the OSC is that there are only two big main files. You have the command line file, which holds the UI, the handling of the syntax, and then you have the core.py, which the name already says, it's the core. There, all functions are in the core.py. So if you have to debug something or you want to add new commands, yeah, you have to grab a lot of stuff and look where you can put your new commands to. Another flaw of the OSC is that you can do similar things in a very different way, in a context-sensitive way. If you are in a package directory, the command looks other than when you are in not in a package directory. So a few examples. Here is the command OSC abort build. So what does abort build do? It restarts the build. It doesn't abort it, it restarts it. That's basically one thing that's also a little weird with the OSC, that the commands do different things than that they are named. So you can do OSC abort build home mstriegel cause, which restarts the, which restarts the build. Then you can do OSC abort build home mstriegel cause, OpenSUSE factory and architecture. And you can also do these types of commands. Now we are in the package directory, and you can say OSC abort build minus repo OpenSUSE factory minus arc x86464, which we start the build for this architecture and this repository. And this does exactly the same, but it looks completely different. So, yeah. And I don't know if you see the command at the bottom. Yeah, that's, yeah. Markus mailed me this command yesterday in the evening. I already had a few beers as I got this email, and I looked at this command and said, huh? What the hell? And it practically ignores the minus minus arc, and the minus minus repo get completely ignored. It just rebuilds the OpenSUSE factory x86-64. So my first guess was, okay, it's an end. So it restarts the OpenSUSE factory and the leap, but no, that's not how it works. So you see, it's kind of not intuitive to do something with the OSC command line, unless you know what you're doing and unless you know exactly how the syntax looks like. So the new approach was to have the same syntax for every command, regardless if it's local or it's a remote project, so that you don't have this context style syntax anymore, and you have to check, okay, am I in a project directory or am I in a package directory, or do I something completely remotely? It's always the same syntax. For that, Markus decided to use a command line, URL-like syntax. Why ouch? Yeah. So you have the OSC2, and then you issue the command, and then you have the API, which is the alias you give in the OSCRC, which defines the target. And then you have project package /project/package, and then the other things come, like /repository/architecture, or in case of a request, /request ID. That's the basic idea behind it, that you always have the same syntax, and that the arguments are always in the same place, that they are not given somewhere with minus R, and the next command they are given with minus minus R repository or completely different things. So that's what we want to do. Also, we switched to a test-driven development, so we first do the tests and then we implement the functions, which is I think well known in the state of the art. And we splitted the core module, although the core file which holds all the functions, and the command line which holds all the command line interactions with the user, were splitted in sub directories. And these directories look like this. So we have the OSC CLI and then the command, for example, abort build or restart build, which is what it actually does. And then you have the, it's just to initialize it as a package. And then we have, for each command, we have a command.py, which holds the functions, the basic functions. And then we have the UI.py, which holds the interactions with the user, the command line interface, as you would say. And then we use Jinja2 for the output to give the result to the user in a template way, so that you don't have to do the formatting in the functions. So that's the way we want to go. So at the end we have We have a lot of subfolders in the same name as the commands. You always know where to look like. If you have a problem, you know where to put your debug code. Yeah. But the development is still at the beginning. There are just, I think, 7 commands are already implemented from the 86. So it's very few. And this is what this talk is about. It's like a call out for help to the open community, to the open source community, to help us to implement the commands, to discuss, and to bring the OSC2 forward. And you can contribute on GitHub under OSC2. There is already a GitHub project which holds all the commands. And then you can just grab a command, implement it, and yay, a new command was implemented. It can already be downloaded from the Open Build Service under the DevTools SCM project. So you can play around with it, can give feedback to me or to Markus, and yeah. So basically that was my lightning talk. It's just a call out for help for this OSC2, that you contribute, that you discuss with me and Markus on IRC. You can reach me with mstriegel@suse.com or as mstriegel on IRC. Yeah, so feel free to discuss with me. Yeah. Okay. Anyone has understand the question? Okay. Why Python? I could ask you why not Python. It was a decision to use Python. Yes. This decision OSC is already written in Python. Yeah, of course, but you could always use another language. Each language has its advantages and disadvantages. So,
if you're trying debug open build service issues, mm-hmm. I mean, you really have to go to all those language stacks to find where the bug resides. And I've always found it pretty cumbersome. Going to all these languages. And I mean, Perl and C is already, and Shell is already used on the back end. This would have been the opportunity to get rid of yet another language. So that, yeah. But
yeah. We have an.
So if your argument is getting rid of another language, then I propose we get rid of Perl.
Okay, as a Perl developer, I cannot agree with that, but...
I mean, the Python, another example why Python is bad, I mean, probably OSC help takes 10 times as long than starting the whole OBS backend, so it's just small.
I mean, you're right, we have many languages, but on the other hand, I don't think we have much components which we could share between OSC and other parts. What we share is the build parts. This is anyway an isolated package. And yeah, it's. I mean, the decision basically was that the people who worked on it didn't know Python best. And what's good in Python, it's quite well supported also on older distributions. It's supported on all distributions in a good and stable way. So I see some reason for Python. It's in the end, it's a matter of taste.
And it's easy to want to arise.
Yeah.
Which is a good thing. I'm not only complaining.
I have a question.
No.
I have a question.
Yeah.
As a Python, as a salt developer in this company, I certainly help. I happy that I don't see the parallel anymore. But I have the question: why OST2 rewrite, not the refactor or changing step by step, like UI, for example, or yeah, this way. So you will keep functional software and constantly update it.
Yeah, it was one of the first questions I asked Markus as he was in Nürnberg for the Hack Week. I asked him, hey, why just not a rewrite of the existing code, a refactoring instead of a complete rewrite? And he said the refactor would on a timely base be the same as a rewrite. And he started it as a Google Summer of Code project to learn some new techniques and to, as already said, widen his horizon and to get to know new ways to do stuff. So I think it's completely valid to do a rewrite of a tool that's so old and so historically grown.
And another reason is the current OSC, the old one, has also problems. I mean, we're changing the UI, the interface, so the user needs to be aware that there's suddenly a new way to do the same command, because we have problems with the old interface that it's inconsistent. And we could, of course, change the old command, but then we would make lots of people unhappy because it's constantly changing and you can't rely on it anymore. So it's better to have really a second command, and you as a user are aware that's now the new command, and yes, the commands are different. But changing the old commands would break lots of scripts, and lots of people would be constant unhappy because suddenly again something changed and they need to check and say.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, I have a question if there is a plan for OSC to no longer by default store password as plain text in home directory, because it's a bit
yes,
annoying.
There are plans for that. It's your chance. Go to GitHub, integrate it, develop it. It's just it's too much to do for just two persons. So that's why I'm here reaching out for you and saying, hey, we need help from the community.
Yeah, I want.
But we do support the keyring, Python keyring stuff, which in the end can encrypt in an own. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah,
but that's
right.
Because you don't have by default. It's SVN compatibility by default. But you can switch over to use K wallet or GNOME wallet or. Or then I think it's also some other implementation for Python keyring.
And one more question about the ouch part. Why not the user interface to be similar as a Git? Since it was SVN compatible, as everyone is using Git, so why not Git compatible?
You mean for the URL syntax thing? I don't get the question here, sorry. I think the plan was to get the syntax from the OSC similar looking to the API calls that you can fire directly against the OBS. I don't know what the intention of Markus was. For this, I can ask him. Suddenly, he's not here today. Yeah. He has a lot of lectures and has exams the next 2 weeks, so he could not make it to this conference. I don't know.
But I think as the OC2 project is kind of young, there's still hope to change things.
Yeah.
Join the development and
it's already.
Give them your ideas.
Yeah, but Git has, what I also want to say, Git has nothing, no functionality like build results or architectures or repositories. So I don't think that's a check-in and add, and so these kinds of commands are different, actually. But But I'm also unsure about the UL thing, I have to admit.
My point was just a question at this time, but I think maybe you can consider that people not really know about the API, but they know about the user interface.
Yeah, that's right. Okay. I think in a few minutes the next speaker will come up. So if you wouldn't mind, I would like to move the discussion away from here, but I'm at the conference the next 2 days. So if you want to like to discuss with me or with anybody else, just come to me and yeah, thank you for your patience.